One.
Hello, you beautiful people, and welcome, welcome to another edition of Performance Ensemble Conversations with. This is actually a very special episode. They're all special, but this is a special episode because we're kind of wrapping up the season. And so we are wrapping up the season with some amazing guests. Cannot wait to share people that you already know and love if you're in Performance Ensemble. And if you haven't met them yet, you will now fall in love with them. I guarantee it. I am one of the hosts of this program. My name is Jefferson Denham.
And I'm the other host. My name is Fernando Martinez.
Right. And so we are going to introduce you or reintroduce you to our very special guests, Holden Streetly. And I think you all know Sir Sanford. Again, if you don't, now you will, and you will love them immensely. So we're going to talk a little bit about today's agenda is loose, as it always is, because we want to see where the conversation takes us. But we do want to highlight both Holden and Sir and whatever performance ensemble, hello, whatever expression of art that they are bringing to the table to this episode. We would love to share that with all y'all. And then we'll talk a little bit about where those pieces came from. And then part two, if you will, is we found some things in the news. You know, we always want to stay current and talking about things that are of value to you and us as human beings and students of Performance Ensemble. So without further ado, I'm going to hand it on over to, we'll get to you, sir. Hang on a second. So Holden, let's start with you. We realized, by the way, before I let you talk, you were our very first guest.
Wild.
So we had to have you. And this will not be the last time either, I'm sure. So how are you, my friend?
You know, I am good. I woke up less than 20 minutes ago. I'm an absolute train wreck of a human being, you know, and part of that is just, you know, train wrecks don't keep a good schedule. So here I am.
You're staying in the moment. That's what you're doing.
Exactly. Like, I can't like get myself tied down and bogged down with all this scheduling and time frames and deadlines that people are always throwing at you. You know, I'm an artist.
Right. And you know, let me ask you, I'm going to start off by asking, you know, we were talking a little bit before we hit record about how, you know, we've emerged from the pandemic. Mm-hmm. We developed all these things that we've just been doing as the not new normal, it was a sort of a placeholder normal, and now we're emerging again. And so, yeah, we're going to have to reconfigure our routines and whatnot. Are you finding that to be true in your life?
Yeah, definitely. I'm currently at my work, I'm getting a bunch of professional development opportunities, and it's so funny how I'm having to like, so many of them are like early in the morning, and I'm having to like, oh, I am so used to like working until 10:30 at night and then hanging out with my friends on like Discord all evening, and then going to bed at like 2 a.m. And I need to manage that a little bit better if I want to be able to partake in these opportunities that I'm being given. Yeah, definitely needing to make some adjustments for sure.
All right. Well, one thing we will not adjust from is your art. And so no matter what time frames you find yourself operating in, we want to highlight for our audience, but even for Fernando and I, we're big fans of what you do. So you have something that you'd like to share with us today, yes?
Yeah, so I have a piece that I created for a class back at CSUN that never really got to see the light of day too intensely, but I loved it because it was a poem that I had worked on for a long time dealing with some really intense trauma that has defined me in many ways throughout my life and my experiences. And my boyfriend and I actually, it was one of the first artistic things that we like got to collaborate on solely as us. It was a huge learning experience for me in many ways too. And I'm sure a huge learning experience for him. And I was just really grateful for the way it turned out. So I did the writing script rearranging and then kind of collaborated with him a little bit on how I wanted things to look. But for the most part, he took over on like video editing, special effects, shall we call it? And yeah, and it turned out amazing. It's honestly probably the thing, one of the things that I'm the most proud of. And yeah, and I've just, it's never gotten to like be shared with people. I think because it's so intimate that I'm like, oh my God, I'm nervous. But like, I'm kind of at the point now where I'm like, let's just do it. Let's just like throw it out there.
All right, I'm excited. So how do we do this? Are you gonna share a screen? Or
I guess that's the vibe. Let me see what's going on here.
So, we have the technology.
We have the technology. The question is will the technology have us? Cool. I think this should, yes, optimize it for a video clip, share the sound. Perfect. Okay, hold on. It's making me do my system preferences.
All good.
Oh, Zoom. Oh, no. Zoom will not be able to record the contents of your screen until you quit. So I'm going to have to hop out real quick and come back in. Is that all right with y'all?
Yeah. Don't stay away too long.
No. Okay. I'll try.
Oh, wait. Hold on. It's saying that, what did it say?
It says that I have to allow it to record my screen in order to share my video.
Oh, okay.
Thank you, dear audience, for hanging with us, because yes, as you course. Can see, life is messy.
Mm-hmm,
yeah. Anybody out there perfect? I didn't think so.
I think one of my favorite things, go for it. I'll be right back. One of my favorite things is that whenever something happens and we always say that we're going to edit it, we never do. It's just like the whole thing goes in filters.
Keep it in, man. That's real life. So, sir, I saw that you had, was that your therapy dog or what?
Oh yeah, this is my Sukani. She might as well be a therapy dog. She doesn't have papers, but she should have papers. She's very attentive and very loving. So she'll like, if anything's going on, she's just gonna be in your face, pawing at you.
I love it. I'm so happy about that. So while we're waiting for Holden, again to our, so Holden, hold on 1 second before you share. Just a real brief hi, because I don't want to leave you there silent. How are you?
You know, I am doing well. It's been a lot of transitional moments, a lot of recovering moments as well. And I'm just learning like how to really sit strong in myself and really just accept certain things as well as be confident and more trusting in myself. So I feel like I'm walking more in a more confident way and I'm communicating a bit better. It's been a time.
Amen.
I'm here. I'm doing good. I'm doing all right.
Beautiful. All right. So that's a placeholder. We're going to come back to you. Dear audience, that's what we call a tease. That's like a tease in the middle. So, all right, Holden, are you all good? Technology
yeah, behaving looks like now? We should be good. I just didn't want to share.
It says that your screen is sharing.
Yes, it says to share my audio, I have to use my admin, my install a Zoom audio device.
Huh.
You're sharing Zoom where? Yeah, okay. So here's what we're going to need to do. I think we might need to start with Sir. And I might need to hop onto a different computer if that is okay with my good friends over here at the PE podcast.
Yeah, absolutely.
We are flexible. We take it as it comes because that's what life does.
All right.
So yeah, I'd love to. Let's go to Sir. So Sir, you started by saying how you're recalibrating. And can I just say something? And maybe people in our audience know this. You know, I'm in therapy. I have been for years, and maybe, dear audience, you might be in therapy. Good on you if you are. And so one of the things my therapist was sharing is exactly what you touched on, which is taking the moments necessary to be still. That's so, let me ask, there is a question in here, sir, I promise. But it seems to me that that's really difficult because we are so used to, in the modern technological age, jumping from one distraction to another. Because to sit still and really deal with who we are is probably, I don't want to be too grandiose here, but it is probably one of the most difficult things to do. Do you think that's true to say?
Yes, I do. I think the human experience, like alone, is a very interesting challenge, I would say. It's different than to work with it, because I'm in therapy too. It's different to work with it through your own personal challenges of human experience with other people, but then to do it alone, it feels so daunting sometimes, right? For example, I went to the movies yesterday by myself for the first time ever in my life. I used to go a lot with my mom as a kid, and that was like kind of the only thing we did. We'd walk. And we have the same food all the time. And that was our thing. And now I went for the first time as an adult by myself. And it was so emotional. I was watching In the Heights, by the way. Ooh. Great musical and movie. And it was not only without tearing up because of the musical, but I was like, I felt like a kid, but I felt kind of liberated because I was by myself. But then I felt sad because I was alone. But I chose to go, you know? So it was very... interesting process, but I feel like that's going to be a thing I do for myself now, is take myself to the movies. So,
and you know what I love about that, and Fernando, I'd like you to chime in before we see your piece, which we want to do, but what everything you described is wonderful in my estimation because of the following. To always be willing to grow and challenge yourself, you have to be able to put yourself in positions or situations where you are now going to be vulnerable yet again. What I found fascinating about what you said was just the act of going to the movies alone. You've never done that before, you said, as an adult. That's amazing. And then to be aware of all the things that are happening within you. And dear audience, maybe you've experienced this. I certainly have, where you feel a little, how shall I say, emotionally constipated. And you don't know how to access or let out what you feel. And so that's one of the things I really appreciate about you, sir, is that you put yourself in a position where you can get the feels, right?
I always do that for some reason.
No, I find that wonderful, because for people who are stuck, and I have been in that position before, it is so... awe-inspiring to see people who have access to those things. And I think that's what makes you such a brilliant artist. Fernando, what do you think?
I think, well, first I just want to point out the whole going to the movie theater thing alone, like as an adult, because the first time I ever did that, I don't know if you guys ever heard of this movie called About Time. It's like some romantic comedy, and I just went to go see it by myself at 11 a.m. I skipped class to go see it, actually. And it's such a weirdly, at least looking back at it now, it's a weirdly restorative thing. So I get that. But as far as I just feel like you have to give up something, you know, in order to create something. And I feel like Sir is always in that space of giving up something, but it's not damaging, and it shouldn't be, right? I don't think sacrificing is the right word, but it's like a sacrifice. You're making a sacrifice for something. But yeah. And look, Holden's back.
Yes. So before Sir shares, I just want to say that I'm with another podcast. I interviewed a guy who is part of a group called Blueprint out of Vancouver, Canada. And he has a lovely illustration. He says, you know, when we're growing, when we're leaving one thing behind because we have to grow to the next thing, he likens it to the illustration of a trapeze artist. And so you're holding on to one trapeze, but to get to the other one, you have to let go of both before you can get to the new one. And I just, that's been sticking with me. And so what you do in spades is you do that. You are not afraid to be that trapeze artist and swing from one thing to acquire something new. And you'll never get to that other one unless you let go of this one. I don't know. I'm superimposing that on you because I think that applies to you.
Yeah.
Does that resonate with you? Do you think that's true?
Yeah, it does resonate with me. I realize it kind of dawned on me now that a lot of my performances with PE have been those performances where I'm all like, I'm jumping off the bridge. I don't know where I'm going to land. I've never done this before. Oh gosh. What did I sign up for? But I'm doing it to myself only because I feel like I have to face that fear head on to then figure out what's next and if that's what I needed to do. And then eventually I'll learn from that. So I feel like a lot of my pieces are very go big or go home in the sense for yourself. And sometimes it's it's kind of like jumping off a cliff into the water.
So, you know, for anybody that's watching that's never experienced PE before, that is one of the things that all four of us, I think, could attest to, is that you discovery. I think PE is about discovery. And a lot of times it's discovering something brand new about yourself you just didn't know you had, or it's revisiting beautiful things in you that you've suppressed. So I love what you said, sir, because it sounds like you embody, and Holden does too, and Fernando, for that matter, embodies this idea of discovery. And there is a little bit of a frightening aspect to it, because growth is a little scary. It's leaving the familiar to discover something new. So anyway, without pontificating too much, we want to hear from you guys. So I'm going to say, sir, you've got a piece to share. Is that correct?
Yes, I do. All right. Before I share this piece, I actually have a little, I shared two clips of it on my Instagram, but actually had an original piece I created for this here. And I don't know if, well, you don't know this, that it was kind of a farewell, but not like a goodbye for Fernando moving on to his, you know, next journey in life. So this is also a tribute to Fernando, but also a tribute to you, Jeffrey, as well, when we also had our first piece together. So I use the same music that I use in that piece with y'all that helped me kind of break through in my first group movement piece, to then use on this movement piece I did here. So this is for y'all. Okay. I hope it plays right. Sound. All right. 1 second. Can everyone see everything?
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm going to start, but I think we're all going to want to say something about that. Yeah. So the first thing I'm going to say is your sensibility is just, you did that for me. I think that piece was just for me, because it resonated with me for a couple of reasons. One is the integration of nature, the way you did it. It reminds me of how there's miraculous things all around us, hidden in plain sight. It's like there's beauty everywhere, but we're just so busy running or looking at our phone or whatever, we just don't see it. Mm-hmm. And then as your hands emerged, there was a sense of revealing. This is the word that kept coming back to me. Your hand is revealing things about you. There's something about art that's beautiful when you sort of do it piecemeal. You don't reveal everything in one fell swoop. And so instinctually what you did was, like, as I'm watching your hands, oh, look, there's ink. And I always think whenever I see ink, oh, every bit of ink tells a great story. There's a reason for all of it. And so it's like, ooh, that's intriguing. And then your hand turned and I had a friend who did palm reading for a while. So I just saw the lines in your hand and I just thought that's revealing. So again, the word revealing, but in such a way that pulls me as the audience to stay curious. You don't reveal so much that you told the whole thing. It's like reading a great book, listening to a great song. It just comes at you in just the right amount of information to keep you going, ooh, I want to know more. And then to see you come up at the end and just look, I don't know. So those are my just knee-jerk responses to, I'm a big fan of what you do. And so I thought that's how it hit me. So Fernando, your thoughts on this gorgeous piece.
I was going to say, I feel like you were, it's like reading my mind because, okay, so just, I think in terms of staging, everything almost always feels so centered, right? Like everything is center stage. You have your marks on stage. You need to know where you need to be standing. The lights are hitting you a certain way. Like you have to speak a certain way or whatever, right? Everything is marked on stage and everything is centered, especially when you're planning it. But I think what was cool about your piece, Sarah, was that everything was out of frame, you know? And whether or not that was intentional, I think it served the purpose of your piece a lot better that it was out of frame because you didn't see everything. You saw your arms like moving around, right? It was like a purposeful like flailing of the arms. And the only thing that was sort of centered was the sun poking through every once in a while, and that was it. But that you can still imagine what everything else with the rest of the body looked like, despite it only being the arms. And then I think you recenter everything the second that you stand up again. And so that's what I really enjoyed. And I've been wanting to do stuff like that. So seeing it actually happen and knowing that it works was really cool.
Awesome.
Holden, what do you think? What are your thoughts?
Yeah, so a couple of things come to mind for me. So the first thing is I loved the contrast between the quality of movement behind you, like those trees and that wind. It's like it really pulls you in. It's almost hypnotizing. And the quality of the movement of your hands and arms. And one thing that came to mind was, are you familiar with the concept of polyrhythms?
No.
So polyrhythms, and this is I have a very rudimentary understanding of these things. Please forgive me. But polyrhythms are essentially when you have like one rhythm happening at the same time as a different rhythm. And one thing that can be kind of interesting about them is that like sometimes they'll sync up for brief moments before they break away again into like a completely different, into that completely separate different rhythm that's happening simultaneously, right? And there was this moment where so much of the time your hands were doing these really beautiful fluid movements and then the trees would just kind of be going all over the place. But then there was this one moment like right near the middle where as you were doing like this kind of a thing with your hands, the trees were also just almost like they were following what you were doing. And I just thought that just spoke to me so much. Like there's there's this idea that man and nature, or yeah, not man, but you know what I mean, people and nature are kind of separate, and that we bring organization to this chaos that is the universe or something, when the reality is we are chaos itself, we are the universe itself, we're all kind of in sync and lined up. And yeah, I mean, I think that's something that I've always admired about the quality of your work, sir, is that it feels in touch. It really feels just in touch with the universe and with a part of yourself that doesn't need to be organized by the society around it, right? Like I remember the first time watching you, I think I can't remember what you called it, but called like, I'm just gonna vibe for our little PE talent show that we did. And I was just like, I love this. I was like, this is beautiful. It's just like allowing something outside of you to work on you and Yeah, that's something I've always appreciated about the quality of your work that I thought was really here, was just that in tuneness with everything around you, with the music, with the environment, with all of it. So I love it.
Go ahead, Fernando.
Sorry. Yeah, I actually wanted to add to what Holden was saying, because I think that's actually a really cool way of looking at it for anybody that doesn't know like polyrhythms. Obviously, like you hear that in music. So when you think of polyrhythms, you think of sounds. But what's cool is that with Sir's piece, you witness those polyrhythms in movement. And you don't typically think of those things as something that is physical, right? Because it is a musical term. And I think you explained it like well, Holden. It really is just like two different beats or rhythms that conflict with each other, and at some point they actually intersect. And I think that happened with Sir, and you know, and that like wonderful flailing, and then the trees also just like doing this thing the whole time. And I think that's a wonderful way of explaining it and appreciating it too, that you can see rhythm in a way that isn't just musical, especially a polyrhythm. JD, I don't know what you were going to say.
Yeah. So I just wanted to say a couple of things in addition. One is, dear audience, we're obviously, you know, talking about how this affected us. Think about how it affects you. You may or may not have the words, and that's okay too. Did you feel something? Honestly, that's what PE is all about. And so the connectivity that we're all feeling with what Sir is doing is our reaction to it. Think about your own reaction. And then, secondly, I wanted to add and ask, actually, because, sir, we want you to tell us the inspirations for what you did. But because I know you, like Holden said, you like to vibe, you like to stay in the moment. Is it weird? I'll just start off by asking this. Is it weird to have a piece finished? Does it ever feel finished? In other words, here this is, but if you were to do it again today, it probably, I don't want to put words in your mouth, it probably would keep evolving. Is that fair?
I would say so, because I feel like all of my pieces are just collections of like what I'm going through in my life, and my life is going until it's not, right? So it's just my pieces I don't think are ever really finished. I think at the end of like my time, they're then a big collection of a different piece that kind of shows like my mark here. So
talk to us about like how you came about creating what you created.
Yeah, so first I was trying to get inspiration of creating a piece to show, and I was just stuck. I was like flailing around in different places. I didn't even find that tree space on my roof until like I was trying to record different dancing and push my body to do different things that it wasn't doing. And I was just getting really frustrated, and I was stuck, kind of like you mentioned, I was stuck. But I kept looking back at that tree in the sun, and I was like, it's just so nice. I was like, it's just so nice over there. I just want to go over there. So what I did was I had my tripod on my phone, and I walked over there, and I was all like, it would be cool to have that in the background. But it, like, for what? You know, I was attracted to that space. And then it felt kind of like, as everything was going on around me, I felt like a certain peace with the wind going and whatnot. And then again, right, another inspiration was Fernando. And also like that Fernando is moving on to a different space and doing that. And then kind of all these years we've had in PE together. And I thought, after a while editing, I was like, oh, let me pay homage to the first time we did a piece. And I also wanted to ask y'all, how did y'all feel about watching it with the same music undertones and kind of translating it into, oh, since like that old piece and now this, hearing the same music, it made me, I want to know like your thoughts. But it was like, honestly, the thoughts with my hands was like waving a goodbye, but in multiple different ways. Mm-hmm. But also knowing that it's not a goodbye, it's just a transformation of different things, of coming back or going towards or shaking hands, type of stuff like that, to kind of know that it's never really a goodbye, you know, it's just a transition time. And
I don't know about these guys, but I saw, you know, some of the movement looked like you were swimming, and that gave me the sense of constantly arriving, never arriving, but constantly arriving kind of thing, in motion and so forth. And then you did this piece, which gave it spirituality. So those are the things I noticed. But you were asking us about the music. So I just found it to be, well, the first time I heard this music is transcendent. It gets you somewhere. And you just responded to that music. So I think if I just heard the music, I would like it fine, but I cannot hear it without seeing you. And so that's my reaction to that question. I'll let these two answer it.
Yeah, well. Holden, if you want to go first.
I mean, I wasn't there for the first time this music was used.
Right. But I was, no, but did you see the show or no?
No, I didn't actually. I joined PE. Actually, I believe I joined PE because of the piece that I'm planning on sharing, and the performance professor who watched it was like, you should join Performance Ensemble. And I was like, okay. But I mean, I will say the music is beautiful. It feels almost familiar. Which I think just speaks to the power of Sir's piece. You know, like there was something about it that I was like, yeah, this feels familiar. This feels like something I haven't seen in a long time, but have known before. And yeah, so I mean, if that was part of it, if that was part of the intention there, I think it worked.
It's funny. Yeah, I always forget when people join and all that. It's confusing. I just felt like everybody was there the whole time. But with the music, the way that I was thinking about it was, to me, the music is the act of like thinking critically or being in deep thought, and you don't realize that you're in deep thought until you're like, oh wait, dramatic music, something is happening. I'm thinking hard about this right now. I'm trying to like get everything and translate everything and try to understand what, you know, Sir's trying to portray in their performance, when in reality it doesn't have to be that way. It can be something simple too. You can just like watch and enjoy. And so that's what the music brought me back to. It's like, oh, it feels serious, but at the same time, I don't have to be super dramatic about it. You know, I can just like sit down and be calm and just enjoy it and take in everything that Sir is giving us in the performance. In addition to that, I wanted to ask a question because I feel like this is one of those things where people sometimes laugh at performance art because we ask really weird questions. But I was wondering with the placement of the camera, because it's like you said that you saw the sun and the trees and everything. You're like, oh, I have to record with that, right? But how purposeful was that exact placement? Or did you just like find a spot, set your camera and just record?
Well, it was purposeful to the fact where I felt like I was stuck in a space. I was going through a lot actually that day. I'm not gonna lie to y'all. And I just needed to, whatever it was, the way the trees were moving and the sun was coming through, I felt like was a place I just wanted to float into. I wanted to be the trees. I wanted to feel that type of peace and just let everything kind of like wash away. And, you know, again, like, I sometimes purposely try to unstick myself. And sometimes I have to literally move spaces and go into certain environments or move out of a certain environment to do that because I realize how much an environment affects me. But it was because like wherever I had left my apartment, I was on the roof for a long time, just chilling, playing music. And I just felt like I needed to find a space where I didn't feel what I was feeling that whole entire day. And that was a space I could do that. As well, and I'll always keep that memory of, okay, that's the time I got through that and got past it. I like to have my tattoos. I like to have like literal stamps of like, okay, you got through that. You get what I'm saying? Because sometimes it feels like some stuff is just like how, but I need to know like I actively have done multiple things and on record, not only in my body, but in real time. That it's possible to get to the other side. Yeah.
So just to tell our audience, if you've never experienced PE, one of the things we like to say is there is no wrong answer as long as it's authentic to you. There's no wrong answer. You can't do it wrong as long as it's honest and authentic. So I'm gonna segue then. I just think that's a great way to tee up this whole episode and tee us up to see Holden's piece too. So Holden, is there any setup we need to do, or should we just experience it and then talk about it?
Let's just experience it and then talk about it. I will say content warning, sexual assault. That is something that comes up pretty frequently in the poem and in the piece. But so if that's not your vibe, feel free to tune out for a little bit and you can come back and have a discussion about it maybe. But yeah, so let me see, let me hop over here. Let me get this all set up now, get my share screen going. Share. Perfect. All right, can you all see everything?
Yeah.
Oh wait, hold on 1 second actually. Oh, oh my goodness.
Technology is hard to
recently heard.
Lord have mercy. Thank you for being patient with me, everybody. I really, really do appreciate it. I just wanted to optimize for a screen share of a video clip. Let me know if you can't hear anything, okay?
So far, so good.
I recently heard you will not know that you have a trigger until you experience that trigger. But a trigger can be a word, a sound, a place on your body that you don't like to be touched. But you will not know that you have that trigger until you are triggered by that trigger. Tonight is the big night. Tonight is the night that I get to be like all the other kids. Tonight is the night that I will sneak a boy into my house, and I am going to have the sex with him. That's right. We will sneak silently into my room and lay on my big blue bed, and I will finally be catapulted into a world of normality where I can put a few fingers down during a good old-fashioned game of Never Have I Ever. Part my lips to impart on you the part of this story where someone can picture this. I recently heard straddling me. You will not know that you have a precious boy inside my house until you experience his head pressed against mine, bowed in the awe of my body, his fingers caressed gently down my chest. Sound timing begins to slow. Place on your body, fingers brush the skin. You don't like to be touched. Waistband of my underwear. You don't like to be touched. You don't mind touched. Hips, 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 hips. My body is jolting, literally shooting forward like a deer when it hears the first fatal firing, when it's fight or flight, flee with all your might into the dark forest night. But I am here, laying on my bed, with a handsome young man on top of me, thinking that he has done something to hurt my body. And the worst part is that I partition off these parts of my memories to part ways with these feelings of falling apart, with these feelings of being apart. So I partition off these parts of my memory because I can't part my lips to impart on you the part of this story where someone touched my parts. No, wait, the worst part is every part of the story since that part. Every little snip. Every little section.
Every little part.
Blending all together to form some kind of monstrous mosaic image. An image of me at 20 years old sitting in a car with my best friend. Parting my words to impart the parts of part, and I part, and I am torn apart, and I say, I think I was molested. I think I was molested. I think I was molested. I haven't been the same since that night. Trauma made my life a kaleidoscope, shifting images across time and space, a mirage of scars dancing across my skin. Scars I never knew I had. Suddenly, it all seems to make sense. My need to be taken apart, used up until I am too empty for anyone to expect anything of me. A shell, a hollow home. I need for you to understand why it is that I wake up every morning in sheets soaked in tears and blood. Why it is I can't have casual sex. How do I tell you there is nothing casual about this for me? How do I say I know it's a hookup app, but I just need to be held? How do I say no without it sounding like a cry for help? How do I tell you? I recently heard the worst part. You don't like to be touched. My heart don't like to be touched. Straddling like to be touched.
Pressed against.
Don't like to be touched.
My body
don't like to be touched. Don't like to be touched.
My
don't like to pry open my wounds.
Be touched.
So someone can get a good look at them. Don't like sheets soaked in tears and blood. Why do I feel like a monster for wishing you'd have the decency to
kiss me on the mouth? Please.
Hi, everybody. So, yeah. Hello. Thank you for bearing witness to that. I appreciate it a lot. Again, that's something that I haven't shared with very, very many people for quite obvious reasons, I'm sure. Some really intense stuff that I've gone through in my life. But yeah, I'm not really sure where to start in talking about this. So I would love if anyone has a question, a thought, a comment.
Yeah, Holden. Because that's the thing too, like obviously, as you can tell, we're all sort of with our jaws through the floor, you know, like it's, how do you respond to something like that? And I feel like this is one of those things too, where I like don't even think it's necessary to ask like why you, the artistic reasons behind anything, right? I think the biggest question that I want to ask is, what has being able to perform this, being able to perform your trauma done for you, has done for your trauma? Like, what has it meant for you?
So first of all, I want to say a huge shout out to my boyfriend, Tim, Timothy Reese, at tim.hawfilms or Timo Makes Films on Instagram. He's wonderful, fantastic video editor, did really, really, really wonderful work with this. And yeah, I think that working on this piece, especially collaboratively, right, with my partner who I know cares about me and loves me and has literally done just as much for me as this piece has done in helping me, like, you know, cope with and process everything that has happened to me in my life, was really, really healing. I think a big part of what I went through is that as I mentioned, you know, I think, was that I didn't really have ownership over that. I didn't really have ownership over the feeling. And in many ways I felt, it didn't always, almost always felt like I was exaggerating in a lot of ways. And like, I was like, oh, I'm making things up and I'm overthinking it. In many ways, I had convinced myself for a long time that what had happened to me was a completely normal experience. And so being able to perform this piece and have it be elevated to the level of impact that I feel like it actually has had, was really, really powerful for me and really affirming for me in my trauma, right? Like, again, like so much of what I had experienced before was about me undermining it. And so to be able to perform something where I was like, not the sole, but the primary proprietor of the information and how it's presented, and to be able to say like, yes, this is my experience. This is something that happened to me. I'm not going to caveat things and be like, well, you know, X, Y, Z, and therefore, I'm making excuses and blah, 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 to be able to just be like, no, this is something that happened and it's had a very real impact on, as I mentioned, like the way that I interact with people romantically and sexually and the way that I interact just with society in general, was really powerful for me and really very healing.
Yeah, I think that...
I'm just going to say really quickly, because I just got to step out for 1 second. I'll be right back. I'm still processing everything, so I shall return.
Okay.
Yeah, what I was going to say, Holden, because it's also one of those things, too, where, you know, because I think that on this show, I think one of the things that we're always asking is what the purpose of what we do is, right? Like, what we serve, what it does for us, what it does for our community, because obviously a lot of it is, it's social justice based, right? And then typically when we think of social justice, we think of community, but we never really think of the individual. We don't really think of the self. And because I was going to ask you too, I was like, well, I mean, this is what it's doing for you too, right? But I'm like, well, yeah, it is. And I think it does something like that for everybody on an individual level, which is that we don't recognize it. And I think that through your answer, it's like we're realizing, oh, but you recognize it, or at least you've started to recognize it, and you were able to perform this. And to follow that up, I was going to ask you, is it still difficult for you to look at this performance, right? Because it's not that it's reliving something, but it is reminding you of something that did happen. Is it still difficult for you to be able to look at this performance?
Not particularly. Because this is like knowledge that I carry with me like every day. Right. And so in many ways, it's very much like, no, I think the first few times it's always nerve-wracking showing it to people because it's intense, and like I am always not worried that people aren't going to be receptive to it, but that people will be uncomfortable or be like, oh my god, like why are we watching this. But like I don't know. It's not nerve-wracking for me in the sense that like, oh my God, this is something horrible that happened to me. And now I have to like relive the memory or the trauma. I've had this piece, that poem that was written, which was revamped a little bit and recut in some ways to help it translate better to video. That poem I've had for years and years. I had been sitting on that, and like and actually what's funny enough is like for years I had had, there was a, that the ending of it had like never been written, and the ending of it wasn't written until this piece was made. Like when this piece was made, I was like, I don't really feel like we have like a place for it to like stop. So I had to like kind of go back in there, and it was astonishing to me to see how like how much healing I had already done and how I was able to get to a place that felt like a natural stopping point, which still, I mean, the ending there is still pretty bleak, but it's not like I wasn't even like there when it was originally written. So I think it is not like traumatizing to necessarily go back and rewatch it. There is that concern about making people uncomfortable. And when the piece was created, there had been a lot of processing that had been done as was. So I think that, especially now, I think that's the reason I was comfortable sharing it, as I was like, I think I'm in a better place about this and able to kind of open up about it a little more.
Yeah. So do you mind if I just say something really quickly? Three things. First is, what an honor. I feel honored that you felt comfortable to share this. I think our audience feels honored too, because that is a vulnerability that is so hard to get to. It takes a lot of courage. So thank you, Holden, for sharing that. Secondly, there is a dark power to secrets. Mm-hmm. I think this is a veteran of therapy talking. When you have these dark thoughts or dark experiences and you just hold it in, you think no one will ever understand, or you know, whatever barriers we come up against to keep it inside. The fact that you brought it to light defangs the monster a bit, still powerful. It doesn't mean it wasn't horrendous what happened. But what you did, Holden, is you give me and people who have had any sort of traumatic experience license to say, I can express it too. This is something I never thought I'd be able to say. I'm too ashamed. Whatever the self-talk that keeps us from processing this thing fully, your piece gives us the permission to go there and bring it to the light of day, right? And that way, other people can see it, process it, and gives them license to do the same. I'm thrilled that you did this piece with your partner, where you felt safe to collaborate and express it with your partner, who you know is trustworthy, who you know loves you. And lastly, I'm just going to say, we all have trauma.
Yeah.
And to varying degrees, some of it's very dark. Some of it people don't even know. They can't even remember that. Like you said, in processing it in private, we explain it away. We say, maybe it was my fault. Again, I just want to say thank you. I feel privileged to have seen this. And thank you for giving our audience the permission to go there themselves.
Yeah.
So thank you for your courage in doing it.
Of course.
Yeah, sir, do you have any words for any respond or reaction to the performance?
Yes. I'm glad you both went first, because I was taking a minute to really process everything myself. And I would say that there was a certain power that was held within that video that showed me that you were in control of every part of reclaiming that space and reclaiming the way you reinterpreted things, right? And it was very, I don't know the word right now, but it was very impactful to see you still tap into those very vulnerable moments and also physicalize them. To even go into a space where you were in certain positions, right? Or even carry the certain light of the darkness, or even the way you had the shades coming in, to even tap in like, okay, that's the color. Okay, this is the position we need to be in. This is it's a different thing to just speak on it, but then to, you know, physically act things out, mm-hmm. right? It kind of also kind of tapped into my brain of like exposure therapy.
Yeah.
And I feel like you did that in a very powerful way. And it brought up so much for me that I'm still processing as I'm even speaking from other different experiences in life. And I'm like, wow, to even hear your response after being like, no, I could see how much I healed, kind of just reminds me of like, you know, where am I at now? You know, and in the healing process, and, you know, just again, knowing that you can get to that other side to where you could even do something like this and talk about it and share it to some people. Like, this is something people only share with like one or two friends in private, and hope they don't tell anyone, type of thing, you know? But yeah, it's just honoring space for yourself, but acknowledging the impact that it's had on your body and your mind, and all the people involved, and knowing like, okay, that happened. What do we do now? Or where are we at now? And what do I need now? It's just very, very, it was very powerful. It was wow.
Yeah, and I think to add to that too, I feel like we should also, if we haven't done it enough, also just appreciate, because I said that I wasn't going to, but I think I do want to appreciate the artistry behind it too. That anybody that has seen you perform knows how well you perform with your voice. And I feel like that's one of the strongest things that I've ever witnessed in all the years that I was in PE, right? It's like, I mean, everybody's talented, right? And everybody brings their own thing to the table, and not everybody's an expert, and they're still so good at it, right? But when I remember the first time I heard you showcase what you might do for PE for our show, I was like, oh man, he's good. Like I was floored, and I'm like, I was just astonished, right? And so obviously I'm accustomed to that quality of work, and you clearly see that here, but it's also kind of amazing to see what that means when it's translated to something that isn't typical of PE, or I mean, it has been during the pandemic, but it really isn't typical of PE to use video, right? It really isn't. Or if it is, it's only video, but nothing is actually translated, and you did that. And yeah, a lot of credit to Tim, right? Because like he did that. Like that's his thing. That's his art, and he's good at it, obviously. But a lot of it also came from you, right? It was both of you doing that. And so seeing the way that you were able to picture it being translated is also really cool to see. And I want to show appreciation for that as well.
Absolutely. And so for our audience, just to know that I think that we're all operating under a thin veneer of what we think is normal. And so what Holden has demonstrated, what Sir demonstrated, what you'll find in PE is that there's a whole bunch of things going on beneath the surface. And if you participate in performance ensemble, I think it expands your appreciation of all those gray areas. There is no black and white. It's all that happening at the same time. So Holden, you just demonstrated it in a beautiful way. So if anybody's watching this and is curious about PE, you're gonna find that as you discover things, and Holden, I think you felt this too, that there is always a safe space. So it gives you ways to access parts of you that needs your inner courage. But again, just Holden, thank you for how you did what you did. And it is, as Fernando said, you've got such a powerful, sometimes intimidating access to your instrument. Yeah. And it's just so wonderful to behold. And you just can't, like, Fernando used the word, like, you're kind of like this isn't the word you used, Fernando, but like, I'm awestruck. You're watching somebody performing something that's so connected, and it's transcendent, I say.
Thank you. I appreciate that a lot.
Absolutely. So I want to segue into another part, because we know that art is not created in a vacuum, certainly. It all has root systems and whatnot. And performance ensemble, dare I say artists in general, completely have their radar up all the time. And so Fernando and I came across this article. This episode is airing during Pride Month. And we just thought, this is a really cool topic. And because we've got two wonderful human beings here who are sensitive, intelligent, we would love to kind of talk about this for a moment. And you know, dear audience, process this as well. So I was sharing with Fernando, I found this, there's a website or a news source called Axios, and it's fully legit. And you know, everyone says, be careful about your news sources. I will say it too, be careful. So anyway, Axios, check it out. This is a really good news source. So they had one of their items on today's news feed was the following headline. I'll just say it and I'll let it soak in and then we'll talk about it. 2021, the year we're in right now, is set to become the deadliest year for trans Americans. This is based on data that comes from the Human Rights Campaign, or HRC. Let me just also just read a little blurbs in here and then we'll unpack. LGBTQ advocates say the record number of bills around the country targeting trans children this year has encouraged more widespread transphobia and violence across the country. HRC argues that chronic unemployment, poverty, and homelessness caused by discrimination also fuels the violence. And the recorded number of killings in the US is actually below the rate in Latin America, which by some counts has the highest concentration of trans murders in the world. All right, kind of a heavy subject, but again, art does not exist in a vacuum. It is a response to what's going on around us. So sir, I'm gonna start with you. What are your thoughts on this? Just as a subject, and not only how it affects you as a human, but what you think our response could or should be.
It's a really good question. I would say, in all honesty, right, it's pretty tough for me, I would say, mainly because on... I find myself disconnected in a sense, and maybe that's due to the fact that I don't want to acknowledge that that is such a real thing happening. You get what I'm saying? To not only to people that look like me and who identify as me, right? It's kind of a weird disorientating kind of feeling because I have much feed on my Instagram, my email on, you know, trans lives and LGBTQ lives. I see it, I hear it, you know, I've read about it. And that part of the community, or that impact on the part of the community, even with news sources, right, I've always been so fearful of. And I'm still learning how to process that, right? Because it's just hard. I feel like it's really hard for me to even answer that question, to be honest. But I say that it's a bit disorientating for me to even kind of connect with. And it's hard because I think I need to push myself and even recognize that, you know, I tend to run away from news sources about these type of things. You know, I tend to block it out, right? I see it so much, and I know it's about me, but I'm all like, you know, but I also feel like, you know, it's also a disservice at times, you know, because I can't run away from the truth, right? But I recognize that there's this place where I've blocked, you know, and maybe it's kind of protecting myself from that as well. Just because it's so, I have not only this in this community, but I also have, you know, Black Americans, and there's so many deaths, so many dying, like, from all different types of places. And it's like, I feel like, man, oh man, I'm just, there's only, there's a part of me that's disconnected because it's so normal. And I, in the future, I hope to be able to come forward and even actively have a news source app on my phone where I am up to date with current things. You know, I don't know if I'm making sense right now.
Absolutely. Yeah. What a beautiful answer. And can I just say that it seems to me, and Holden, I'm going to kind of preface my question to you because I'm asking you the same question, but I did want to also add to that the following. It seems to me that people, this kind of hatred, it is hard to believe that it's happening in 2021, first of all. But secondly, it seems like it's based on fear of other, fear of something that I don't understand. And this, to me, is part of the beauty of Performance Ensemble. It allows us as an audience to get inside someone else's skin. It pumps up our empathy muscle so that we can understand or imagine lives different than ourselves. And so I think people who are targeting trans people or folks of color, it's based on fear, and that fear is stoked through unscrupulous media and political leaders and so forth. But so I'm gonna start, I've said all that, so I'm incorporating that. I would love to hear your thoughts on that too, but let me just start again by saying, how does this kind of thing affect you, and what could or should we do about it?
Yeah, so Sir and I have worked together in many, many, many capacities, one of which being that we both work together at the Trevor Project, which is one of the nation's leading LGBTQ youth serving organizations. We're an LGBTQ youth suicide and crisis intervention lifeline primarily, but we do a lot of other stuff too, do a lot of advocacy, a lot of research. And like Sir, this particular subject material holds like a very close place to my heart, but it's also something that in many ways I feel quite numb to. Like, I feel like this is something that I'm dealing with in many ways on the daily. you know, in my day-to-day work. And so hearing these things, it's not shocking to me. I'm like, yeah, that is the horrible reality that I deal with every day. I also wanted to preface, I'm not speaking on any part or any, or on behalf of the Trevor Project or anything. These are just my personal experiences, but I will say it's shameful and it is shocking in the sense that why is it still happening, you know, like, why? Right. And I'm sure there's tons of questions. For example, we have people, you know, in office right now who are like in their 80s and have just been around to see so much crap and have no connection anymore to what it's like to not be a politician. And so they have no concern for anything other than themselves and their own monetary gain. That's just one thing.
Yeah.
I think too, but I also think that's an oversimplification, right? I think, especially when it comes to trans children, one of the things that often gets lost in the mire is we forget that I think innately most people have a desire to protect children. And a lot of what conservatives are doing that we are seeing as attacks on trans children, in their minds, they're doing to protect trans kids, are doing to protect their children. They really do believe in their heart of hearts because they're ignorant, they're hateful, they're malicious. I think a lot of people believe like, no, you know, you know, if you're young and you think you're trans, you've just been brainwashed, you know, you've just been you've just been manipulated by this liberal agenda. You've been manipulated by, you've been manipulated by Joe Biden and Kamala Harris, you know, to believe that you are this way. And I think that those people, not all of them, obviously. I do want to shout out, there are plenty of politicians out there, plenty of religious organizations who are purely just being hateful of things that they don't understand. But I do think there are lots of people out there who truly do believe that they're protecting children, that they're protecting kids like from themselves, from making foolish decisions that they just couldn't possibly understand the ramifications of yet. And I often feel that one of the ways that we're going to maybe finally be able to get through to people is if we're able to connect on that level, right? Like the level that it's like, we want to protect trans children because we're like, trans children are children and they deserve to be respected in how they feel and how they want to identify. And these people also are like, well, I want to protect children too. I just want to protect them from making these life-altering decisions or, you know, mutilating their bodies, you know, all this really, really loaded rhetoric that gets kind of thrown around. And I feel like maybe sometimes the responsibility, I think part of your question was, what is our responsibility in this, right? Or am I making that up? I feel like
you're right.
Part of our responsibility as artists is to try and bridge that gap, right? So much of art is based in that pathos, in that emotionality. And I think when it comes to children, and I've talked about this a lot also with the pedophilia debate. When it comes to children, there are strong emotions we have tied to them, probably because childhood is this inherently traumatic thing that we all go through and we all experience. And many people have a fondness and a nostalgia for, right? And so when we see kids, we see a lot of ourselves and we want to protect that. And I think that as artists, maybe our responsibility is to appeal to that as much as possible, is to find those places where the argument really does kind of boil down to those emotional, human, very, very human parts, and to try to dig into those and tap into those to help people understand and see that their actions are not aligning with what they claim their values to be. I think maybe that is kind of what our responsibility is in this case. Yeah.
I love it. I think, Fernando, feel free to jump in here too, but it seems like, Holden, what you just said was, a lot of times we have cognitive dissonance and we make it fit one way or the other. In other words, yes, I love children, but oh my gosh, being gay is an abomination to God or whatever. I know, and I've worked for years and years and years in evangelical Christianity circles, in leadership and elsewhere. And I know so many, and maybe everybody here on this panel and everybody watching knows people who did not want to be gay, did not want to be trans. It's like, oh my God, if I really am authentic and really myself, there's going to be a shit show. You know, my family's going to hate me. My religion's going to hate me. And I had a friend who was just desperate not to be gay. Bless his heart. He's happily married now. And I'm not going to drop their names, but I almost did. But anyway, but he tried not to be gay so much. But at some point, authenticity, we talked about authenticity in performance. I'm going to say authenticity in our humanity is absolutely necessary. I don't know if you guys saw this, by the way, this may or may not be a side issue, but I just saw that there was a recent poll. 70% of America is absolutely on board with gay marriage nowadays. That gives me hope, because think about it. Not that long ago, this was absolutely anathema. If you were a politician saying you were for gay marriage or whatever, it just was not going to be accepted, and now it is. Mm-hmm. So I'm hopeful that through our art, like Holden said, we have a responsibility as artists to build a bridge from one side to the next through empathy, through honesty, through showing our experience so people can understand. Have you seen, and I'll stop talking, you can tell I'm pretty passionate about this. There was something on PBS called Ballerina Boys. It's a documentary, and it's about this troupe made up of all male troupe and they wanted to be ballerinas. So they started this troupe in the 70s, and when they started going on tour in red states, they were nervous. They were a little nervous, like, oh, am I gonna get attacked, what? And what they found was through their art, because there's comedy involved and whatever, they won people over, because you show the common humanity. I feel like that's to me, that is our responsibility as artists, certainly as humans. But let me ask you both, and I will stop with this. Let me ask you, what do you think for those of us who want to be advocates? We can think, oh, this is what you do from an outsider's perspective. But what do you think we should do to be healthy and supportive and effective advocates?
Well, one thing that I think is important that I kind of wanted to bring up because you were touching on it and because I touched on it too, right? So I think there's importance to bridging that gap and finding the common humanity. I think there's also importance in recognizing that there is common humanity, but we also should really just have respect for one another, right? Because so I think sometimes when we lean too hard on that common humanity, we fall subject to, I think it's something that's called, there's some academic articles out there, if I'm correct, about what's called like homonormalization, which is essentially not that homosexuality becomes normalized, but that homosexuality, there is a norm that is created for homosexuality. There is, like, for example, a lot of depictions of gay men in media right now are, and they're, a lot of them are loving, kind, they're great, right? But so many of them are monogamous, completely 100% monogamous relationships. We're married, we have children, we have family. I can count on one hand, and I am running full queer circles, I can count on one hand the number of fully monogamous couples that I know. Most, I can't speak wholly, but I will say a lot of gay, especially gay men, but also gay women, also just, you know, non-binary folks in relationships have open polyamorous relationships, because there's an understanding about, you know, like loyalty, respect. There's a big term that gets thrown around a lot, which is compersion, which is essentially the opposite of jealousy, which is feeling joy at seeing your partner have a positive experience. So like, for example, if they're dating someone or having sex with someone that they love, you might feel compersion and be like, I'm so happy that that's happening for you. But but because media is kind of tossing around this image of this, like, well, all, you know, all gay men, like, they just want to have a, they just want a husband, they want a child, and they want their two-story bedroom on White Picket Fence Lane, and that's what they want, right? But I, again, I know plenty of people who, that is the furthest thing from what they want. They're like, I don't ever want kids. They're like, I want to be going to clubs with my husband when I'm 60. Like, that's my, you know, that's my ideal. And the thing is that, like, I don't see anything wrong with that personally. I'm like, listen, if you two want to have sex with whoever the hell you want to have with, and you are in this happy relationship living in your apartment in West Hollywood until you're literally 75 and pass away together, that's perfectly fine with me. But I think that sometimes when we lean too hard on that appealing to humanity, we start to partake in limiting people to what they can do. And I fear that in some ways, the same thing has already started to happen with the trans community, right? Like, for example, look at Pose. Pose is been a groundbreaking show. It's made a lot of really fantastic strides for the LGBT community in terms of representation. But if you look at all the women on that show, all of those, you know, fantastic, talented, incredible trans women are all cis passing, near white in many ways women, right? And they're all women of color, but they, you know, that's touching on colorism a little bit, but I'm touching more on, they all look in many ways cis. And there are plenty of trans folks out there who don't pass, whether it's because they quote unquote can't, or they don't want to. You know, they're like, I'm not here to, my transness is not here to serve some idea of what a man or a woman is supposed to look like. My transness is here to serve me and to allow me to live authentically, right? So I think our art is important in helping bridge that gap and showing that humanity, but I also think we need to be careful in how it is that we dig into that and bridge that gap between humanity. So I think as advocates, especially as folks who maybe aren't part of the community, it's thinking about who looking at the screen, for example, and thinking, who do I not see? And how can I work to elevate their voices? Is it making sure, you know what, like, I'm not seeing a lot of disabled trans folks on the screen, or I'm not seeing a lot of disabled trans folks in performance. Let's try and find some folks who are interested in doing this and elevating whatever ideas they might have, trying to find ways to advocate for them in our performance, or to advocate for their ideas in our performance, right? Like, if it means like, hey, we're looking for someone to direct a piece, we're looking for someone who can speak to these experiences. We're a troupe of performers just looking to, like, help, you know, elevate that message of that cause. I think that is a way that we can be good advocates. Just echoing or elevating their voices, using our privilege, right, to lift those voices up.
Fernando, any other questions about that? Because I love that. Thank you for sharing that, bro.
Yeah, no, I'm glad that you brought it up, although it is kind of frustrating that you typically only see it in academic circles or academic texts, right? Because then you're sort of like gatekeeping that information from the public who don't have access to it. And that's a whole nother issue that we can talk about. Mm-hmm. There's so many issues in the world, but yeah, the idea of this like homonormativity, because it applies to literally every single social issue, right? In addition to this one, or it's sort of like, it's this like appreciation of the subaltern or whatever, but through the eyes of the people who are already in power. So it's like, is it really this, or is it this whole other thing, right? But I think that the last thing that I just want to say, though, is talking about responsibility, because I think that something that we've done on this show is we always recognize one, the fact that the work that we do is always in the name of social justice, be it for a group or be it for the individual, like we were talking about earlier when discussing your piece, Holden. But the other thing that we do is also recognize that we have, and some people find it simple, like we have months dedicated to certain things, right? And so we always want to appreciate that and talk about that. Like today we were just supposed to perform, but we found a news article that we wanted to talk about. And It leads me to the third point, is that we do have a responsibility in being able to translate these social issues and putting them or reworking them in a way that makes it a little bit more accessible for some people. Because for some people, you can't just have these conversations that we're having. We do it easily. For other people, it may not be so easy, whether because they struggle to understand it or because they refuse to have these conversations or because they're not given the proper resources to be able to have these conversations, right? So it does become our responsibility to be able to translate those things and do it in a way that's much more feasible to understand. And to me, that's the stage. And I think that's what that does, right? To me, it's I liken it so much to like performance art is punk rock. Like, that's what it is, you know? And I think that's the best way to understand it. And I think that this is a really wonderful place to end the show today. And I just want to thank JD for being my co-host, for joining on to the second season, even though there was no PE this semester. I know. To Holden for coming back, for being our first and last guest on the show, for Sir, for taking on so many different responsibilities with us, from being a guest. I think this is number three. It's like appearance number three for you, Sir. But also co-hosting the show with me, and often last minute. Like, the Sir does a lot for us last minute, and we appreciate that. This has been CSUN Performance Ensemble Presents. I always get that wrong. In conversation with, my name is Fernando Martinez. I am one of your hosts.
And my name is Jefferson Denham. I'm the other host today.
And again, we just want to thank you, Holden and Sir, for being on the show. And we are now going to wave bye while I find the stop button.